Quantum mechanics is the branch of physics that attempts to explain the behavior of very, very, very small things. This behavior at the smallest scales appears bizarre because we don't see it in our everyday experiences. Even down to the scale of things we can see with ordinary microscopes, classical physics predicts behavior very accurately. The classical physics of Newton and Einstein is precise, predictable, and deterministic. We're comforted by this. We know precisely where a basketball is going to go when we throw it up for a shot. Quantum mechanics, on the other hand, appears to be based on probabilities of finding an object here or there. We don't know and can't know where an electron is in an atom until we look at it, until we measure it, at least according to one interpretation. Yes, quantum mechanics is so bizarre that there are different interpretations of what might actually be happening. In fact, there is no majority consensus on any one of the interpretations. There is a particular interpretation, however, put forth by graduate student Hugh Everett that was considered preposterous in 1957 when he first proposed it. But it has now become mainstream and is gaining huge support. But it requires us to change our paradigm about our experiences of reality and consider that there may be many, many universes or worlds where every possible quantum outcome happens, and that we are living in just one of those branches of the universe at any one moment. One of the biggest proponents of this so-called many worlds interpretation is Professor Sean Carroll of Caltech. I spoke with him via Skype recently, where he answered some of the biggest questions I had as a skeptic. What is this crazy interpretation? Could we really be living in a universe of many worlds? What is the mechanism of the branching, and how does that occur? The explanation and answers to questions from Sean Carroll are coming up, but I just want to take a moment to tell you that I was inspired to do this video because of a documentary I watched on Magellan TV called Secrets of Quantum Physics, hosted by none other than Jim Al-Khalili. If you like my videos, then you're going to love Magellan TV, this video sponsor. It's a new type of streaming documentary service that I think you're really going to enjoy. It was founded by filmmakers and producers who bring premium, in-depth documentary content. Featured subjects on Magellan include history, nature, and my favorite, science and space. You can watch it on any of your devices as well as your TV anytime without any ads or interruptions, and in 4K. Magellan TV has an exclusive offer right now for Arvin Ash viewers. If you use the link in the description, you will get a free 1 month trial. I highly recommend Magellan TV, but be sure to use the link in the description. Before we look at the pros and cons of the many worlds interpretation, let's take a look at the most popular and what is considered by many to be the standard interpretation of quantum mechanics. It's called the Copenhagen interpretation, championed by Neils Bohr in the 1920s. In simple terms, the interpretation suggests that objective reality doesn't exist until it is observed or measured. The quantum world is governed by a set of probabilities and is described by a wave function that evolves over time in the Schrodinger equation. The act of measuring forces the set of probabilities to randomly assume one possible value. So according to this, by observing the quantum world, we force it to choose one of several possible paths. Prior to this observation or measurement, the microscopic world exists in a state of all possible paths at once. An electron does not spin up or spin down. It is in a state of spin up and spin down at the same time. When we measure it, it takes one of these states. The many worlds interpretation, on the other hand, postulated by Hugh Everett, says that the entire universe is in a state of superposition. A measurement may look like a particle has some set of properties, but that is not the overall reality. It posits that the world splits every time we think a quantum measurement is made, and that although we may see one thing in our world, there's another world in which another thing has happened. So for example, if we're trying to measure the spin state of an electron, the many worlds interpretation says that our measuring device becomes entangled with the electron. This causes something called decoherence. The decoherence splits the universe in two, such that in one universe, the device measures spin up, and in the second universe, the device measures spin down. Both universes exist. We just happen to experience one of these universes. We could just as well be in the other universe. And similarly, this kind of decoherence is happening all the time, and in every instance this happens, the universe splits. So this is why it's called many worlds, because many such branches or splits of the world exist simultaneously. So this raises a lot of questions, but let's look at why this is getting popular with physicists when compared to the standard Copenhagen interpretation. In the Copenhagen interpretation, there are two sets of rules. One set of rules applies to the system prior to measurement according to a wave equation, which is essentially a set of probabilities for the state of a quantum system at any one time. And a different set of rules applies to systems after measurement has occurred. The many worlds interpretation says no, this is not the way the universe works, and that there are only one set of rules for everything. And that rule is that all systems abide and evolve over time according to the Schrodinger equation. And there are no probabilities because all possible outcomes are a branch of the many worlds. Now, you might not believe that branching of the universe can occur, but I will show you by splitting the universe into two branches right now. There's an app called Universe Splitter that I recently bought. I'm going to put in one of two potential choices and ask the app to pick one. Now, when I do this, it will send a photon to a partially silvered mirror in a lab in Switzerland. The photon will have a 50% chance of taking one of two paths and reports which path it took. Now, I'm going to ask this app to help me decide between eating this lollipop or this apple. Okay, so I'm going to give it a try now. Okay, so in the universe where I made this video, I am going to eat this apple. So, that's the video that you are watching. But in another universe, I am eating a lollipop in my video. That universe is just as real as this one. You may or may not be watching me in that universe, but I'm eating a lollipop there. So in many worlds, the universe is not random and probabilistic like it is in the Copenhagen interpretation. It is deterministic, according to the Schrodinger equation. The randomness is just our perception because we only experience one of two branches. Now, both interpretations are weird, but there's some good points about the many worlds idea. First, it gets rid of the measurement problem. We use the same equations whether we measure something or we don't measure something. There's no special role for the observer. Second, it lets us apply quantum mechanics to the entire universe. This is quite elegant. And three, there's a 100% chance that the world will be in a state of superposition of me eating the lollipop or eating the apple. From an overall perspective, there is no uncertainty. Both outcomes have occurred. But this also raises some serious questions. First, what is the mechanism of branching? How does that occur? Second, how is energy conserved? And third, the puzzle is, why do we see only one world? If the other worlds are equally present, why can't we experience them? Where the heck are these worlds located? I pose these questions to the foremost expert on the many worlds interpretation, Sean Carroll, theoretical physicist at Caltech. His latest book is called Something Deeply Hidden, Quantum Worlds and the Emergence of Space-Time. The link to his book is in the description below. I highly recommend it. So first, I asked about why the idea of branching is better than the idea of wave collapse. Take a listen. It seems to me you're replacing the mystery of the collapse of the wave function, which is mysterious in Copenhagen interpretation, with the mystery of the branching in the many worlds interpretation. So can you talk about how the branching is less mysterious than the collapse would be?
The problem with Copenhagen is that it is manifestly an incomplete theory. Mm-hmm. Nobody can possibly think it's the final answer. You say when you observe a quantum system, its wave function collapses. And if you ask, well, when do you observe? What counts as an observation? What about one atom bumping into it? Does that count as an observation? And also, what is the underlying reality that is happening? What is the real true mechanism that is going on beneath the surface? Copenhagen just says, we don't know. That's not our job. We're not going to answer those questions, okay? We know it when we see it, wave functions collapsing. Whereas many worlds is 100% completely specified. There's an equation, the Schrodinger equation, and that's it. There's nothing that deviates from the Schrodinger equation at any time. So there's no mystery about when branching happens in the Everett interpretation. You have the Schrodinger equation describing the behavior of physical systems, and those physical systems interact with each other and they branch, which is to say there is an environment, there is a set of things out there in the world that we don't keep track of. All the photons, all the molecules of air in your room, you might know some coarse features of them, but you don't know the position and velocity of every molecule or every photon, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't keep track of that. And therefore, when a quantum system becomes entangled with that environment, that's when branching happens. And we can quantify it, we can tell you how quickly it happens, we can tell you when it happens. There's no loose ends there anymore.
So according to Sean Carroll, in many worlds, the Schrodinger equation always applies. It's the entanglement of two systems that causes a decoherence leading to the branching. So the question is, what the heck is decoherence? It's not quite like wave collapse. It can be thought of as a loss of information to the environment. When an isolated quantum system, like say an electron, gets entangled with its environment, which contains things like photons and other molecules that may be present, this has the effect of a transfer of quantum information. All the photons and atoms that bounce off the electron are agents of decoherence and can fix the electron's position in space and give it a sharp outline. It's as if the environment is always observing. This is decoherence, and it's the cause of the branching. And this is how quantum systems can start behaving like classical systems. So for the second item, here's what Sean Carroll had to say about the important question of energy conservation. Energy conservation. It feels like, you know, where could all the energy come from for these new worlds? Now, in one of your interviews, I saw that you mentioned that we can't really think of it in terms of new energy being created, but rather the energy of the Schrodinger equation being fractionalized into new worlds as they're created. I'll quote you. You said, each world gets a little bit thinner, although its inhabitants can't tell. So what does it mean when you say that a world gets thinner?
So there's two things going on. I think that this, and this is again, you know, this is not like a question you ask because you don't get it. This is an important question that we need to sort of think about what it means. It's a legitimately difficult question that is new to the many worlds way of looking at things. In many worlds, there's two different things you might mean by the energy of the universe.
Okay.
One is the energy of all the branches of the wave function. Okay, like all the worlds at once, that has an energy. The other thing is what the energy of each individual branch looks like from inside, okay, to the perspective of the people inside each branch, what is the energy? And these are two things, they're different things, but they're related to each other. And the relationship is not that you take the branches, the energy of each branch from the interior point of view and add them.
Okay.
That's not what it is. Sorry. That's just not what the math says. What the math says is take the energy from inside each world that the observers in that world would say, weight it by the wave function squared, right? Every branch of the wave function comes with an amplitude, a number. This is where the probability comes from, right? That amplitude square is the probability that you find yourself on that branch. The energy equation works exactly the same way as the probability of being on one of the branches somewhere is always going to add up to one. The energy of the universe that you get by adding the energies of the individual universes weighted by their amplitude squared will always add up to the energy of the total universe. So the total universe with all the branches has an energy which is 100% conserved. The energy within any one branch is almost looks like it's conserved. It's not quite exactly conserved because there's quantum fluctuations, but it's pretty close to being conserved. So when you branch the universe in two, the energy of that you perceive in your universe doesn't decrease by half. It stays almost exactly the same.
So essentially what Sean Carroll is saying is that the total energy of the universe in all its branches is conserved, analogous to the way that all the individual probabilities inherent in the Schrodinger equation add up to one. And finally, something that bugs me a lot is if there are many worlds, why do we experience just this one world? Here's what Sean Carroll had to say about that. Why is it that I experience just this branch? I'm conscious of this branch. I am not conscious of the other branches.
look almost exactly like identical twins, which at one point were the same single cell fertilized egg. Okay. Mm-hmm. But rather than just duplicating its cells and becoming one person, it split into two different people. Nobody says those identical twins are two copies of the same person. That would be a weird thing to say. They're different people, right? Mm-hmm. When the branching happens, there are now two different people. They had the same past, but they're different people now.
So I think Sean Carroll did a great job of demystifying the common questions around the many worlds interpretation, and he also answered several other questions. If you want to see the interview in its entirety, you can view it on my Patreon or YouTube membership channel. Now, I came in as a skeptic, and I remain a skeptic, although less so now than before. I think the math is there to support everything that Sean Carroll says. I don't think there's any disputing that. But should the universe be interpreted based strictly on mathematics, regardless of its intuitive aesthetics? Perhaps it should. Or is there a deeper truth that would be more satisfying? No test can tell us the difference between the outcome of the two interpretations, Copenhagen versus many worlds, because they both give you the same outcome and both invoke the Schrodinger equation. Both interpretations seem bizarre. It's a matter of choosing the one that seems less bizarre to you. A non-deterministic universe with probabilistic realities, or a deterministic universe, but with near infinite realities that you can't see, except the one that you're in. The wise advice, according to some scientists, is, look, it doesn't matter what you think or subscribe to because the equations give you the correct answer. So stop thinking and just shut up and calculate. I asked Sean Carroll about that, and he, like me, hates that idea. I myself think that physics is more than calculations. It is a science that tries to get at the truth about what the true nature of reality actually is. That's what we should really be after, I feel. And that pursuit, at least on this channel, will always exist. I'd like to thank my generous members on YouTube and Patreon. If you like videos like this, consider joining them. Feel free to share this video with your friends. Post your questions below. I'll try to answer all of them. Thank you for subscribing, and I will see you in the next video, my friend.